primary school children are classified as obese. That, of course, comes as immense health costs and economic costs. So overeating deranges metabolism, it reduces quality of life by adding excess weight. We got immense costs to the NHS, so although figures vary, the estimates for indirect costs to the NHS are between 2.6 to 15.8 billion for sick days and benefit payments. Beyond physical health issues, such as certain cancers, high blood pressure, we also have physical issues. So low self-esteem, depression, feelings of worthlessness, and all of that is perpetuated, that's a hard word, for the social consequences of being overweight. So social exclusion, discrimination, and even financial disadvantages at the workplace. I think we can all agree that when we eat more food than we need and we drink more sugary drinks than we need, we put on weight. It's not quite that simple. Obesity is caused by a complex interaction of genetic, behavioral, and environmental factors. So energy in, energy out is not really the formula for that. What I'm interested in and what I focus on is media and advertising. And media and advertising has been implied as a significant contributor to obesity for various reasons. I would like to discuss two of them with you. So first of all, in order for food companies to generate profit, they need to sell more. You can only sell more if we eat more. So there's a constant encouragement for everyone to eat more of anything that's on the market. So we're overeating in general. Also, you will find an imbalance in advertising content. So 98% of advertising is for food that is very high in sugar, fat, and salt, contains nearly no vitamins, minerals, or fiber. Those foods are generally referred to as junk foods. So we see a lot of junk food on TV, on billboards, on social media, on flyers, everywhere, and only 2% is actually for food that is considered healthy. So vegetables, fruits, and whole grain products. Massive imbalance in advertising that gives us and children a very skewed idea of what eating is like, what normal eating behavior is, and what even healthy eating is. That is also reflected in the amount of money that is being spent on advertising. So that's US figures, and you can see in 2012, $4.6 billion were spent on promoting fast foods. It's so much, I can't even imagine that amount of money. For fruits and vegetables, it's only 120 million. So we have encouragement to eat more and more and more, and we have encouragement to eat foods that are not particularly healthy for us. Advertising directed at children is of particular concern because eating behaviors and food preferences are established early on in life. So those first impressions make a lasting impact for years to come. Children learn through observation and imitation. And media and advertising is a mass educator. It's a source of information, it provides norms about eating behaviors, and it is even used as a source of information. So I want to make sure that those first impressions are positive ones. The second issue, amongst many other issues that we currently have with media and advertising when it comes to food, is that children develop their understanding of advertising over time. So it takes around primary school age, children will be able to distinguish between what is advertisement and what is the actual program content. Now, if you have SpongeBob SquarePants advertising cereal to you, as a child you might think that's a valuable source of information and that this is healthy foods because SpongeBob SquarePants says so. So media can be very confusing for children. A more holistic understanding of advertising can remain ill-informed until teenage years, so to actually understand the intent of advertising, which is to sell you things, takes a lot longer to understand. And I think, according to research of Huan, if I pronounce that correctly, even adults struggle to identify advertising when it comes to online marketing and search engines. So we see advertising is quite tricky. Then, childhood obesity is a particular concern. 5 minutes, Jesus. I really like this topic. So childhood obesity is particularly worrying because once obesity is present, it's really hard to treat. So prevention really is key, and obesity is on the rise in children. So intuitive eating is something that we're all born with. It's the innate ability media interferes with that and destroys it. And I think this is an ability we need to preserve in every child and in every adult. Media cope at the moment as the opposite of that. So I really think that advertising, if anything, is a missed opportunity. We could use advertising and media to role model positive eating behaviors, to establish positive norms around food, and that's currently not happening, and that's what I want to see. That's okay, right, so we managed to cover the background. The research aim is quite easy. I want to see what is the potential of advertising to improve health and well-being in children and adults and parents. Now, we're quickly going to go through the theories, participant hypothesis, procedure, and materials, and some upward implications. I think we're all familiar with social learning theory. Bandura's famous Bobo doll experiment, children model aggressive behavior, if they've seen it before. Then we got cultivation theory, which suggests that repeated exposure to consistent media portrayals and themes influence perceptions in the direction of these media portrayals. This research comes originally from studies into crime rates. So people that watch a lot of TV tend to overestimate the crime that is in real life, because you see an awful lot of crime in every film that you watch and every TV series. So heavy viewers think that media actually represents the real world out there. Now this has been used for binge eating as well, and I think it might be useful for my study, because I would like to see a media environment where healthy eating is the norm, and where we all think that everyone's eating healthy, and hopefully we'll use that powerful social psychological principle down here, social consensus theory. It is really important to us what we think other people think. So if we think everyone else is eating healthily, hopefully we do the same. My participants are parents who need to provide consent forms and answer a short questionnaire about their children's media use and eating habits, also age, gender, socioeconomic status. And children come from a local nursery. They're between 2 and 4 years of age. What they have to do in my study is watch episodes of Shaun the Sheep, the whole season, and I have advertising clips embedded in that. So kids think they're watching Shaun the Sheep, they're also watching advertising, and I want to know at a buffet afterwards, what foods do they choose now? Do they choose healthy foods, or do they still choose the very popular junk foods? Of course, my hypothesis is positive. I hope if we show kids healthy food, they will also want to eat healthy food. I think if you think about calories, that will have a massive impact. If kids manage to switch from chocolate bars to cucumbers, the caloric difference is going to be huge. So, if you were a participant in my study, I would ask your parent to sign consent forms, to fill in the questionnaire. I would randomly allocate you to watch 1 out of 4 advertising clips. That's what they look like. I designed and produced, with the help of an amazing volunteer group, a pro-healthy food ad, an anti-junk food ad that was really difficult to produce because kids do like chips and they have to pretend they don't. Then a pro-junk food ad, which is our current media environment, and a control group. So you're allocated to 1 of those 4 conditions, and afterwards you're led to a buffet by yourself, so you're not influenced by the other children, and you can pick any of those foods. So on the right side we have water, vegetables, fruits, and whole grain bread. On the other side, what we will label as healthy and unhealthy, although I'm not happy with this black and white thinking, but for the sake of the argument, healthy and unhealthy, because we can all agree that it's better for children to drink water than fizzy drinks. I think we can also all agree that it's better for children to eat vegetables than eat chocolate. So it's about small behavioral changes that have a big impact. Right, so I'm recording those food choices and the intake at baseline, then after 1 intervention session, midpoint and endpoint, and I hope to have a follow-up 2 months later on as well. I will monitor that by using paper sheets, and I also want to try if kids actually manage to use an iPad and take images themselves. So it's a bit of a pilot to see how can we actually do research like this. And I'm really happy that Pennystone Nurseries have participated in this. So, implications. I hope that I can confirm the negative impact of junk food advertising on children's eating behavior. There's also already a lot of research about that. And I want to make recommendations about the type and amount of advertising that's useful. So what kind of ads do we have to show to what kind of kids to improve their eating? In the larger sense, that's contributing to a clean media environment that empowers children, parents, and adults to make more healthy choices. Fine, thank you very much.
So, do we have any questions?
Can I say one more thing?
having me. Thank you for that. It was really interesting. You said you don't agree with this black and white distinction between healthy and unhealthy. Can you elaborate on that a bit?
So I think the dietary guidelines in the UK say that anything can be enjoyed as part of a healthy, of a balanced diet. So it's about moderation, and it's about making sure that you get enough of those foods in your diet so that it's no problem having these foods at all. So it's more about reaching a balance. And I think labeling foods as healthy and unhealthy is also incorrect, because one piece of chocolate is not going to tip you over the edge. It's really about how much you have of that and if you can counteract it with more healthy foods. But also, I struggle to come up with a better label. I tried less healthy and more healthy options. At the moment, I stick to healthier choices because I think it makes sense to choose these over those foods. But the thing is, also black and white labels lead you to the idea that there's something as called forbidden foods that you shouldn't have. Kids will want those forbidden foods even more because they're special treats. So I don't want to put them on a pedestal by saying this is the forbidden thing and you can only have it on your birthday.
Thank you.
You mentioned that you're going to do a follow-up after 2 months. Is that right? Are you expecting to see an effect then that long off? Are you just showing them one advert? Or
No, we're actually showing those clips over an 8-week period.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
So for 8 weeks, they really get to watch a whole season of Shaun the Sheep with always the same advertising clip at the beginning, in the middle, and at the end, as you would see on TV as well. And then only at specific points, I'm doing the buffet as well, because otherwise it would be too costly and it would take too much time.
Right.
Still, I don't know if it's going to have an effect 2 months later. I hope so.
Have you checked the episodes for influences? What if in Shaun the Sheep they're eating chocolate, for instance?
Yes, absolutely. I had to screen every single episode and actually got my partner to cut the one bit out where Shaun was eating popcorn. It's part of food imagery. I've been dreaming of Shaun the Sheep ever since. Yeah, all episodes are screened. There's no reference to food in them at all.
I believe there's one where Shaun goes to get pizza. Play a role as well, and that's actually why we're putting this massive buffet together. So most recently